on a Thursday afternoon around rush hour time on a heavy traffic night. Thanks for making the trip out. My name is Nick Giuliano. I am a co-founder and the current president of the board of Advance Atlanta, the group that is here tonight. We appreciate y'all coming. Real quick before I start on things, I want to take a moment to thank our sponsors this evening. Those are the Cumberland CID, the Atlanta Regional Commission, the Town Center CID, the Council for Quality Growth, and of course everybody in this room tonight who went ahead and made a donation. We really appreciate y'all doing that, so thanks for coming out. Before we get started with our speakers tonight, and we've got some really great ones, I want to take a few minutes just to explain what Advance Atlanta is, who we are, why we're standing in this room right now. It's a question we're getting asked a lot tonight. So for those of y'all who have not done an Advance Atlanta event before or haven't talked with us, we've been around for about a year and a month. I think actually we're right at the 1 year, 1 month anniversary. Last year, the Atlanta Regional Commission came up with what we think is a great idea. They pulled together what was probably a dangerous idea in retrospect. They pulled together a bunch of millennials from across the metro Atlanta area, and they said, well, we want to hear y'all's thoughts on what the issues are that are affecting our region, how we should solve them, and bring everybody together. Which, if y'all have dealt with millennials before, they have a lot to say about a lot of things and some interesting ideas about how to get stuff done. So it's kind of an interesting process, but what they wound up doing was they broke everybody who had gotten into this program, which was called the Atlanta Millennial or the Millennials Advisory Panel, into groups, and they told us to work on different issues. So there was a group that worked on affordable housing issues. There was one on health, education. And those of us in the room tonight were brought together to work on transportation and specifically transit. And when we had our first little get together as a group, just those of us who were doing transit, we came together and we said, well, you know, every few months we see headlines in Atlanta that say stuff like, you know, the region's ready for regional transit, or transit has deep impacts on our economy, on our way of life. But when you look at Atlanta, we just don't have a world-class regional transit system. You know, we've got a bunch of different agencies that sometimes communicate really well and sometimes don't communicate really well. As Senator Brandon Beach showed in a very funny YouTube video that I'd encourage everybody to go take a look at tonight, it's hard to get from one system to another, and it's hard to get where you need to go on time in the metro Atlanta area. So we said, well, we could produce like a study for the ARC, and we could replicate what we all already know, which is that there's a problem, or we could try to organize and actually start doing something on it. So after talking a lot as a group, we actually just went ahead and we went back to the ARC, and we said, well, whether y'all are comfortable with this or not, we're going to go ahead and form an organization, a 501c4, Atlanta, and we're going to start talking to everybody in the metro Atlanta area. And what we're going to try and do is bring together everybody who has a consensus opinion, thinks that this region would be better served by comprehensive regional transit system and by increased investment in transit access and communication, right? Like, it's hard to tell sometimes where the different systems link up, where they're going, when there are meetings that concern transit or transportation. You know, you may not know when your local city council's transportation committee meeting is. You may not be plugged into that. So we came together and we formed the organization 1 year ago, and since then we've had some events throughout the region. And if you haven't done so already, I'd encourage you to like us on Facebook at Advance Atlanta and sign up at www.advanceatlanta.com. And in doing that, you can stay in touch with us, because what we're really about is bringing everybody together who shares this vision and communicating about transportation and transit issues. You know, if we're going to make it as a region, if we're going to be the most competitive one that we can, we've got to all work together, and that's why we're here tonight. So with that, I want to take a quick moment. We have some elected officials in the room. If you are an elected official, please go ahead and raise your hand and be recognized. We've got several here with us tonight. Thank you very much for coming out. We appreciate your leadership and your public service. And with that, I'm going to go ahead and turn things over to Danielle Elkins, who is our vice president.
I also want to take a quick second to acknowledge the rest of the board that is here tonight. You'll see us designated by the blue smiley face on our name tags. But if everyone who's on our board could raise their hand real quick, if you have questions, these are the people to talk to that have been working really hard over the last year to make all of this happen. Thank you all for what you do. So it's really important that we're here tonight at this time. So we purposely chose to be here on a Thursday night during rush hour to make a point of, it's difficult to get here, it's a challenge, and it's something that needs to be talked about. we all want to have choices in how we get around, and it's important to at least start the conversation in Cobb County of how we're going to make that happen. There's a lot of really important things that are happening right now within the region. In particular, there is a MARTA referendum on the ballot within the city of Atlanta. There's also a transportation item on the ballot in Fulton County and the city of Atlanta for transportation improvements. This is important because the rest of the region is looking at, is this going to pass and by how much? And it will tell us maybe how much we have in potential for success in the rest of the region. It's also really important, we acknowledge the elected officials in the room, to give them the support that they need to make those tough decisions, to do the right thing in expanding transit, where it really needs to go to connect our entire region. So I want to kind of kick it off here. I'm going to introduce each of our speakers as they come up. Our first speaker is the important chairman of the Board of Commissioners for Cobb County, Tim Lee. He's going to talk, and then we're going to introduce the rest of our speakers.
Good evening. It's a pleasure to be with you, and welcome to Cobb County to start out with. I was asked to be very specific, very brief, and as such, prepared my notes so that I can make sure that I can make the points that I want to make while keeping within the time restraints that folks have asked me to stay with. So bear with me if I read as opposed to get myself in trouble by ad-libbing. So I want to thank you for inviting me to be part of this event, and especially for giving me the opportunity to say a few words about my perspective on transportation. Transportation is going through a transformation in the Atlanta region and across our country. 10 years ago, we were talking about planes, trains, and automobiles. Today, we are talking about transit, trails, and driverless automobiles. 10 years ago, MARTA communities were exploring ways to exit from the commitment to MARTA. Today, these same communities are exploring ways to expand MARTA. 10 years ago, transit was only discussed at the regional planning tables. Today, it's discussed at economic development tables. Folks, I can go on and on and on, you know that, but I don't need to, not with you guys, because you, frankly, you get it. And that's why you're here today. The truth is, it's not us in this room, this choir, to whom we should be talking to. We should be speaking to the voters, because the future of our regional transportation system depends on them. As you all know, and I know all too well, we in this room do not make up the majority of the voting demographic who actually show up to vote. I'm a champion of transit expansion and of offering more and better transportation options. I was a very vocal advocate of the T-SPLOS in 2012. And I led an initiative to study the possibility of running bus rapid transit down the Cobb's most dense corridor, connecting the state's third largest university with one of the largest job centers here in the Galleria area, then on to the city of Atlanta. But I learned the hard way that it's not up to me. Elected officials and government leaders cannot change the future of transportation from the top down. This is a bottoms-up discussion. I'll give you a minute to catch up, Jar. Right now, the voters in Cobb County simply don't have an appetite for transit. Or perhaps they just don't have an appetite to pay for it. Either way, introducing the notion of transit was not well received. Actually, the first time around, I almost lost my job because of it. My understanding of that is in Gwinnett, where the political landscape is changing much quicker than Cobb, and the community itself has started the transit discussion, the polls show that right now, likely voters are not there yet. This does not mean we are not making progress. I think the MARTA expansion on the ballot in Atlanta is huge a huge step forward. The transit advocacy work that Senator Brandon Beach is doing for North Fulton is also a major sign of success. And it is beginning of the transformation, that I mentioned earlier. We are moving the dial, and it is your job to move it further and faster. I think that is why you are all here tonight. Now, I've attended quite a few of these events, the Kumbaya meetings, right? We all get together and we think we have the world's solution, and we're going to go out of these doors and make it happen. And we all talk to each other, the believers. We all share war stories. We leave cheering about expanding transit in the region. And I admire and appreciate and applaud Advance Atlanta for your excitement about the advocacy and a commitment to transit expansion. And I contend that most people in Atlanta region agree with you, even the naysayers. There are very few people who don't believe that we need more and better options. There are very few people who think it's okay to be sitting in traffic because it's the only way to get home from work. I personally don't believe that we need to persuade voters that we need more transportation options. In fact, I would bet that if there was a question on the ballot this fall that asked voters if they supported more and better transportation options in this region, including transit, that it would pass by a landslide. But that's not the question. The question before voters is not whether or not we need more transit and transportation alternatives. The question for voters is whether or not they're willing to pay for it. We do not need to convince voters that it's necessary. We need to convince them that they want to pay for it. This is my challenge for you as a group and everyone here tonight. The narrative should not be about the need for transit expansion. The narrative should be around the value of transit expansion. Now, I know you know, and everyone in this room knows, how important it is to economic growth and to job creation. We know how important it is to millennials, our future workforce, and we know how, if we don't do anything today, we'll fall further behind tomorrow, and our region will suffer. But folks, Joe and Donna Voter don't get that. In fact, quite frankly, they don't care. Your job is to bring Joe and Donna Voter into the room just like this, to talk to them about the expanded transportation options and what it means to them and their neighborhoods, their kids and their grandkids. Talk to them about how it will make their lives better. This is not an easy task. It's hard, and it will be hard. But it is the only way to move the dial further and faster. We must convince voters that just like they invest in roads, which they do a lot, their lives will be better off if they also invest in transit and transportation alternatives. This is what we need to do, and this is what you need to do. So I say thank you for the time. So it's my pleasure to introduce one of the people I respect very, very much in this in our community. Forward thinker, a big idea person, a courageous person, someone that is, as you guys will learn in your life, you can probably meet in your whole life less than four people or five people that you can count on that you know that you can take them at their word no matter what and whenever. Mike Plant is one of these men. He's the president of the Atlanta Braves, something. they changed titles over there, like I changed my dress shirts. But he's on the business side of it. And I first met Mike 3 years ago, didn't know him then. But we looked each other in the eye after a couple weeks, shook our hands, and made a commitment to work hard together to create what's outside that window. And the rest is history. He's always over-delivered on everything he said he would deliver. Never fallen short. He's never come up with excuses. He's never been late. He's delivered, and he's delivered on time and on budget and whatever he said he would do. Mike is a great guy, well-respected partner in our community, was
Todd is very proud to have the Atlanta Braves and Mike Plant as part of that team. So I give to you the president of something of the Atlanta Braves, Mike Plant.
Thank you, Tim. I was president of something. I'm going to have to get a card that says that. Better than president of everything, because we've got a great team of people that are making this happen outside. So I'm going to be honest with you. I mean, I'm not here to talk about transit or traffic, or I didn't even know what I was talking about. We do a lot of these events up here in our preview center, and a lot. Right? When I say a lot, there was one last night, there was one Monday night, there'll be a couple more next week. This is where we have spent the last 2 years really bringing people to see the progression and transformation of what, in November of 2013, was a 57-acre piece of land, the main piece of land, and it essentially was trees and dirt. We were starting to move a lot of dirt off the site. So in basically 24 months, we've got 2.6 million square feet of a stadium and development. It's all been coming out of the ground. And again, I've been proud to really be an instrumental leader in this project and have the oversight and the quarterback role in making sure that it's going to happen. And we did that with, you know, Tim and I, we look at each other and we have this little inside joke to ourselves when we say to ourselves, boy, I told you this was a really dumb idea. And so, you know, we understand the impact it's going to have. We talk a lot about the economic impact. There's articles being written about the halo effect. I talk to a lot of people as now I'm a developer that in their lifetime have never dreamed about doing something this big. Tad shaking his head because I respect his experience and career. He's been doing it for decades, and you know, most people say that there's no way we were going to get this done when we rolled this out, this dumb idea we had. And you know, I also know that I've said this and I'll say it till the day I walk out of here. One day there'll be a monument for Tim Lee out there, because we're not here without Tim's wisdom and leadership and certainly his vision and trusting us. I mean, we built this, he and I built this on trust together, and then obviously his team and our team, and that has helped us get to this point. And that impact is going to provide, you know, hundreds of millions of dollars that we're putting into the system. We're not taking out the system. It's going to provide thousands and thousands of jobs just here and that compression around here. And, you know, the flip side of that is we understand there's a responsibility that goes along with that. One of those responsibilities is being a good community steward and a good community neighbor. And, you know, we're putting every type of request we get in Cobb and the school system, and you know, we're giving back. We know we've got a responsibility to do that. We also know that from being a good neighbor is that, look, we're going to have an impact on some people's lives. I mean, we get that. I've said this frequently for the last couple of years. This is not just doom and gloom. We've ruined your life every single day. That is what, when we made this announcement, you know, I heard from some people. I read some of the articles. You know, my life is over. I would challenge anyone to tell me that the last 24 months, if this construction project has had an adverse impact on your ability to move around here. Now, maybe those managed lanes have, but that this project hasn't, and we made good conscientious decisions to make sure that didn't happen. We took 24,000 truckloads of dirt off this site, and we did it when all of you were in your bed, and I was in my bed. It was midnight to 6 a.m. Cost us a lot of money. But we knew that the impact of that out of the box, that if all of a sudden we had trucks all day long going up Cobb Parkway where we were dumping dirt and dumping rock, that was going to be an issue. So we were smart about that. 24,000 truckloads of dirt, never one single article written, because we didn't make an impact on people's lives. We understand starting next year we're going to play 81 games a year. And we understand that with 41,000 seats in that stadium, 9,000 less than Turner Field, that we needed parking. We've got several thousand more parking spaces here than we had at Turner Field. We had two access points to get to Turner Field, and it bogged down traffic. I got lots of calls. Where are you? People are like, oh, Mike, traffic's terrible. Where are you? Well, I'm at Buckhead. I'm like, okay, well, you're at Buckhead. We're at Turner Field. That's a stadium for 1 million people. We don't have 1 million people coming there. So there's traffic going on here, but you can't blame, you know, the Falcons or the Braves or the Civic Center. You got to take that all the information, keep it in proper context, make sure we understand, as Tim said, there's a traffic issue around the town. I'm in it, you're in it every single day. We now have a responsibility for what we're going to impact around the Braves Stadium and the Battery. Work with experts, work with the county, work with the CID, the state, the police, to have a good traffic management plan that takes those 81 days a year and make sure that we get people here safely, we minimize the amount of impact that we're going to have as they're coming here, as they're leaving here. One of the things we looked at as far as all the data on the roads, and I've said this as well, I mean, when we came up with, obviously, the plan we developed with all this team of experts, you should be really worried if I was the guy that led the traffic management plan. That's not my expertise, you know. But we didn't stick our finger up in the air. Sticking your finger up the air and tell how hot or cold it is outside is nothing more than taking a wild guess. And so bringing data and bringing experts to the table, the DRI that we did was the largest, most extensive one ever done in the history of the state. That gave us good data. So I would just leave you with, and I'm going to turn this over to Jeremy, our GM, to tell you a little bit more about the Battery, but we get it. We're going to be part of the solution. We have been part of the solution. It's what we're doing every single day out here to make sure that we have, we minimize the impact, because we know that it'll have an impact. And I just assure you that we understand the importance of that. So thank you for coming tonight. We're about 6 months from opening day, and this is going to be part of a catalyst to transform this entire area. I think that's already happening. We understand the responsibility we have. So thank you very much.
They want to buy tickets. That's what they do.
You want to buy tickets? You're going fast. We do have a couple of our people here. Whitman is in the back, and oh yeah, we got them. They're waving their hands in the back. I'm sorry. If you have an interest in season tickets, Maria, you're going to buy some tickets.
No, not today. Oh. I just wanted to ask a question.
Are we doing questions?
At the end, if you're
comfortable,
you can. But
okay, we're gonna do them at the end. So yeah, if you have an interest in season tickets, I mean, one of the other things I'll just say about the fallacy of, or maybe it's a fact, in a lot of brand new sports stadiums, they cost a lot of money. And we, you know, I loved it one day. Justin O'Neill said at a certain session, what are we doing here? We're going to vilify the Braves. We're investing over $1 billion into this project of our own money. So we're heavily invested here. But we have 4,000 premium seats that we have at Turner Field. We have 340 at Turner Field, 4,000 here. That's amenity-driven seats, food and beverage, and parking, and all those good things that are included, especially some conditioned space when it gets hotter or it rains. Leaves 37,000 our seats. Biggest thing that also does is it allows us to provide our core fan base, which are 55% families with young kids. We'll still sell a $6 ticket across the seat or across the street. I don't think you'll find that anywhere in Major League Baseball. I don't think you'll find that really anywhere that builds a brand new professional sports stadium. So we understand our core fan base and understand that you still need to make it affordable for your core fan base. So, without further ado, I'm going to introduce you to Jeremy Strike. Jeremy, we were fortunate to bring on board about a year ago now, and he is our VP and general manager overseeing the entire Battery project, and certainly when it's up and rolling, he's going to be the quarterback of that. So, Jeremy.
Thanks, Mike. I'm Jeremy Strife, the BTGM of the Battery Atlanta. This works better if we can kind of get as close to the model as possible if you guys want to gather a little bit so I can start to point out a few things. What the major thing to take away from the overview today is the fact that this is the first master planned mixed-use development anchored by a professional sports stadium. Okay? So you've seen some examples in Foxborough with Patriots Place, right? That's a bolt-on. Ballpark Village in St. Louis, right? The ballpark was there first, it was a bolt-on. This is a great example of mixing the two industries of professional sports and a mixed-use community that provides the highest level of amenity and the highest level fan experience while providing a community amenity that is activated 365. So I'm going to focus, based on the topics of today's discussions, on transit, transportation, egress, and some of the programs that we're going to be announcing soon, and some that we've already developed ourselves, and then open it up for some questions about the actual battery. So we start here on site, which we obviously know after your drive-in is at 75-285 on a piece of land that had to be pretty majorly improved, with the petroleum line running from the northeast corner to the southwest corner. That petroleum line is large enough and sophisticated enough that it does pump petroleum from Houston to Maine. So it's a very sophisticated system, and it ran through, which is why the site sat for so many years. So after site improvements, we were able to give ourselves this kind of canvas to plan the orientation of the field, to plan the orientation of the hotel, of the office buildings, of the residential units, of the retail and entertainment, to make sure that outside the 81 days, so 284 days, that it was a really comfortable blend for our guests, our customers, and of course Braves Country, to enjoy the site. So you'll notice coming off 41, there is a throughway all the way to Circle 75. So it is a functioning two-way road that takes you all the way through the asset. It's cut through on Heritage, on, you haven't announced the street names yet, so you almost caught me there. on Heritage, and then the street A, B, C, and D over there. And so what it does is it promotes a pretty healthy egress pattern for vehicles, for bikes, for pedestrians. To enhance those aspects, what we've done is obviously installed the pedestrian bridges over 285 from Cobb Convention Center, and then two bridges that kind of make an L pattern crossing I-75 from Interstate North across Circle 75 and Windy Ridge. So what that does is allows us to connect into the great existing Bob Catlin trails, right, the Silver Comet trails, the great work that that the CID is doing to connect with the green trails and the bike paths. So we are now kind of a central hub connecting that even Vinings and Smyrna area out into East Cobb and across 75. So the pedestrian bridges were big, the original orientation, the egress patterns, and the amount of options for you to get in and out from the various parking structures. You know, the pond deck, for example, is 8 exits all on its own. So what we've done to enhance that is obviously provide facilities that accommodate the people who want to use the infrastructure, not simply providing a connection, but then providing an experience. And so there's a term out there, and you may have heard of this, it was new to me, called transportainment. And so the business that we're in now, in addition to all the myriad of other businesses and professional sports, is transportainment. So now that we're connected in, all right, now how am I hosting our families, our communities, our guests, our fans? Well, what we've done is we're going to be announcing soon our bike station. It's a bike shelter that connects right on our entertainment block that allows you to come in, has sufficient bike racks, lockers, right? A lot of people say, oh, I can bike here, but I've got the elbow pads, I got the helmet, I got the kids, and how am I gonna have lunch? How am I gonna walk around the park, play in the fountain? We provided facilities, including the, it's sheltered, it's lit, it's easy egress from the trails on the north side that will provide lockers and bike racks and a water fountain for families to come in and individuals to either bike to work at one of our 400,000 feet of office space, shop at 400,000 feet of retail, come to the 50,000 foot Roxy Theater for one of the 40 shows during the year, or simply just enjoy the community aspect of our north, south, and central plazas, our 80 foot shade structure, interactive fountains, our stage pavilion there. So we wanted to incorporate all these things as part of our transportation plan. So you get the pedestrian bridges, you've got the bike station, which we'll name later, and then we're also going to have a pedicab service. Obviously, we have a rideshare partnerships that we're going to be announcing as far as active real-time directions, as well as rideshare professionals that come in that make it easy to access the sites. Very popular these days. We want to make sure we're providing a conduit for people who use those functions to get to the site. And then the pedicab service that is so popular in so many green cities. It's very popular in Atlanta. It's very popular in Austin, Texas as well. So bringing in all those major partners, first orienting the asset to be susceptible to those type of green connections, making the connections with partnerships with the CID and Advanced Atlanta, and then investing in infrastructure that supports those who choose to use it once on site is really kind of the game change mix for an asset that's almost never existed before in this function. So the other part of connection that we like to talk about when we're talking about physical connection is maybe more important connection to most people's lives, especially millennials and younger folks and office folks these days, is your internet connection, is your capacity. Is your, okay, now I'm here and what? I'm going through a walk through the park? No, life doesn't stop once you get off your bike, let me tell you. So what we've done, we've partnered with Comcast, and they're going to be installing 50 miles of fiber cable that's going to provide multi-terabit speed throughout the whole asset. It has more capacity than the Pentagon, half of Manhattan. It is the fastest capacity of any mixed-use and professional sports venue in the world. We've over 700 points of Wi-Fi to support those people once they're here. So once you're connected to us physically, you're going to be connected to your world mobily within any step that you take on this site. So the entertainment, the retail, the shopping, the office, the residential units. Our website just went live a couple weeks ago. We're taking pre-leasing names and should start leasing later this year. Only 540 units, high interest so far. And then the easy egress for pedestrians, bicycles, and obviously for vehicles. So that's kind of the general overview. We are on time. We are on schedule. As you can see, it is an ever-changing skyline for us out there. We like to joke around that we take a tour out and have to take a different route every day. I went out today and there was a wall where I walked yesterday. So that's good news for us, but we hope to have a lot of you out here for tours very soon. So if there's any questions about the overview that I just gave, I'm happy to answer them.
We can do the end too.
Well, overall, but as far as the overview that I gave, nothing? Thank you. All right, guys. Thanks, Danielle.
Thank you. All right. Thank you. If we can kind of shift back around, we're going to be now focused on the screens here for a PowerPoint presentation. Presenting, coming from MARTA, is the Assistant General Manager, Ben Limmer. He's going to share a little bit about the state of MARTA right now, which will hopefully give some context into transit.
Okay. Thank you very much, Danielle. Thank you for having me out here to this wonderful facility. It's such a great view, especially for a baseball geek like myself. So here today to talk briefly about the state of MARTA, both from a service providing standpoint, as well as I think I might as well touch on the upcoming activities on November 8th. The city is moving forward with the $2.5 billion referendum to expand MARTA service within the city limits. So I was gonna also briefly touch on some of the details associated with that. So I do not have a clicker, so if you see me point, that is my clicker. Sure. I mean, many of you are familiar with MARTA. I mean, ninth largest transit system in the country, provide heavy rail bus service. We actually have one of the largest police forces in the state. And we also have a very robust paratransit mobility service that connects all riders to the suite of MARTA services throughout our region. As far as what we're working on with expansion, so it's a little slow. Okay, so we are working on 4 expansion projects currently, and we've been working on them the last couple, 3 years. We're working on a red line extension to the north, that's called Connect 400. There's the Clifton Corridor shown in purple. That's an 8-mile project connecting Lindbergh with Avondale. We're working on a blue line extension to the east, the I-20 East extension, as well as a freeway running bus rapid transit project on I-20 shown in orange. So this is our existing service today. It's 46 miles, and future system, you can see what it can end up being. Maybe I should guess what my next slide is. Okay, so some of the things that our general manager, CEO Keith Parker, is working on are in the categories of what he's calling SEAT. So it stands for Service, Economy, Arts, and Technology. So we are working on a variety of new, very innovative things in those four categories. In the area of services, we are really focused on, yes, we are of course focused on our rail system, our bus system, our paratransit system, but what do folks do when they get off our trains and buses and so on and so forth? So we're really focused on this last mile connectivity. How do people get to and from MARTA bus and rail services? So we've really been very proactive at getting as creative as we can. We have, as a matter of fact, formed a couple partnerships with the ride-sharing industry, both with Uber and with Lyft. Those programs basically provide discounts to passengers. Oh, I'm like a couple down the road now. Oh, that's okay. I know most of it. So as well as the ride-sharing partnerships, which can provide discounts from passengers exiting their rail station and making their last mile connection to their final destination, we have also partnered with the city to bring bike share to 14 MARTA rail stations within the city limits. I don't know if everyone's familiar with bike share, but it's basically you swipe your card, you can rent a bike. Oh, there we go, caught up. So this is a photo of the bike share, or the bicycles themselves with those cute little baskets. But what we've heard from our passengers really is we really need better first and last mile connections. So MARTA has been very aggressive in forming those partnerships. Okay, next slide. Maybe it'll like us now. Okay, so as far as the economy goes, we've done a lot of things with forming economic related partnerships. As a matter of fact, just a couple months ago, MARTA broke ground on an $80 million transit-oriented development project at our Avondale station. It's going to bring nearly 400 residential units and I think it's 25,000 square feet of retail to our Avondale station. MARTA was built in a time where we have a tremendous amount of park and ride assets. Some are heavily utilized. I think the North Springs station is above 95% full. But the Avondale station had a couple of underutilized park and ride lots. So we are transitioning those to a higher and better use. That project is under construction. So we look forward to that project being completed over the next year or two. As far as the arts, doing a lot with the arts, a public art program. This is a new mural that was installed at the King Memorial MARTA Rail Station recently in earlier this summer. But on top of that, one of the best things MARTA has done recently is they have earmarked up to 1% of their capital budget for public art projects. The idea here is to make our art spaces more comfortable, more inviting. Hopefully we're going to have functional art, so perhaps, you know, art you can sit on or kids can climb and those types of things. As far as technology, one of the best innovations that we are working on is a mobile ticketing app. So you will no longer be required to carry around your MARTA Breeze card. You will simply be able to pull up the Breeze app on your smartphone and then scan it. We actually have a couple of pilot reader sensors in place that we are testing with like a small group at the Lindbergh station, but we very much look forward to rolling out this program in full over the next several months. Okay.
Can we prefer the card? Can we keep the card?
What's that?
Can we prefer the card? Can we keep the card?
You know what? I prefer the card, so yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Okay, so moving on to the MARTA sales tax referendum. Thought I might as well touch on this since it's coming up. I really like this slide because Atlanta, when it was constructed at the same exact time as San Francisco and Washington, D.C., basically. They are sister systems. And you can see the Atlanta system in the upper left. Meanwhile, since we broke ground on our initial system here, these other cities have constructed dozens and dozens of miles of light rail, heavy rail, even streetcar, and you can see even visually how Atlanta's system compares to our peer cities. But even since 2000, so a lot of those cities started working on them in the late 70s, early 80s. This is a map just showing the cities that have expanded rail since 2000. You can see that it's spread throughout the country. It's in the Sun Belt. It's in the upper Northeast, all over the Western Mountain States and West Coast. These are the projects that have received federal funding. And you can see here, many of them have built multiple projects. On top of this, just this year on November 8th, in addition to the $2.5 billion referendum that's on the ballot here, there's another $190 plus billion dollars on the ballot across the country. Granted, about 130 of that is in Southern California. But we are not alone. Localities are stepping up, recognizing that they can't always go to Washington, D.C. with an open hand. Voters are seeing the value in transit, and we expect a very successful November 8th across the country from everything I'm hearing. The average rate of passage last 5 years is about 70%, according to the Center for Transportation Excellence. They're very optimistic about the rather large referendums that are on the ballot coming up this fall. Okay, so the MARTA sales tax, it came out of Senate Bill 369 this last legislative session. The purpose of the tax is to significantly expand MARTA transit service within the city limits. The receipts are projected at $2.5 billion. Now, I do want to stress that $2.5 billion, it's in today's dollars. It doesn't assume any growth or in population, employment, or inflation, or anything like that. As part of Senate Bill 369, BARTA was required to work with the city to prepare a project list. That list was approved by the Board of Directors in May, and then the City Council in June, and then, of course, referendum coming up on November the 8th. When we were working with the City Council on the project list, we did not start from scratch. I mean, there's been a lot of transit and transportation related planning studies that the city has done, the Beltline organization has done, that MARTA has done, that many of the CIDs have done. What we did is we pulled those all together, and that really drove the creation of this project list. In addition to that, we wanted to work with the City Council on policy objectives, and I'm not going to read these to you, but we were focused on near-term projects as well as long-term projects. We really wanted balanced and connected transit systems. So we didn't want these projects to be in isolation. We wanted to connect them as much as we can. Also, we really wanted to not only invest in expansion, but we needed also to take care of what we currently have. So that is, you know, we did not want to be in the same situation as our peer cities. So next slide. Okay, so this is the map of the projects. We have rail station enhancements. We have infill stations to the existing MARTA system. The green lines are all rail and bus rapid transit. The orange lines show the higher quality, high frequency bus services that are on the project list. We did conduct extensive public outreach. We heard two things from the public, just to sum it up. We want more bus service more often. We want it late night, midday, on weekends, as well as we want significant expansion of the light rail system within the city. Those are really the two most popular items when we did surveys. So here's our schedule leading to the November 8th referendum, and then the program is going to be implemented in the spring. So with that, that concludes my presentation. Be happy to take any questions at the end. Thank you.
So just to wrap it up, I would like to invite up a champion of transit important in this community, the chairman of the Cumberland CID, a sponsor of this evening, Tad Ed.
Thank you, Daniel. You'll be happy to know that I'm your last speaker. Andrew Morseberger likes that. I do want to talk a little bit about transit and what it means to Cobb County. And I don't know if y'all noticed, I certainly did, that in the MARTA presentation that we just saw, they're working on four major projects. There's no line to Cobb, and there's no line to Gwinnett, our two largest population centers. Emory Morseberger just told me that he'll get transit in Gwinnett before we get it in Cobb. And if I lose, I have to buy him a steak dinner. And
it's starting in my CID.
It's starting in your CID. We can't start in your CID. We have to come to your CID.
Yeah. We're working on that.
But the fact is that as exciting as things are in Cobb County right now, and it is exciting. I've been here now for 35 years. I've never seen anything like the economic development that we're seeing, the transportation investment that we're seeing, the public-private partnership that is vibrant right now in this community. But at the same time, a car company, Mercedes-Benz, is ruling us out because we don't have transit. State Farm Insurance is ruling us out because we don't have transit. And more companies that are considering relocating to this area are going to say, do you have transit? And we're going to say no. And they're going to cross us off the list. End of story. So I realize that we have CCT, and I love CCT. I'm not saying bad things about CCT. But if you fly into the Atlanta airport and try to come to this location on transit, you better concentrate. All right, because it's not going to be easy to do, and it's going to take you a long time. I have always believed when I travel, my test of whether I'm traveling to a great city or not is, do I need to rent a car? If I fly into New York, I do not need to rent a car. Boston, Singapore, you name it, London, Paris, you do not need to rent a car. If you want to fly into Atlanta and spend a weekend going to the Braves games, you better rent a car. We have got to address that. And MARTA or ATL or whatever you wind up talking about, nobody is going to push transit on us in Cobb County. Until we invite transit to come to Cobb County and embrace it and say that this is something we need in order to continue to be a vibrant community, then we're simply not going to get transit. They're going to go where they're invited, which is north into North Fulton County, out to Stonecrest Mall, and the other things that you saw in the previous presentation. The Cumberland CID has been in business since 1988. In 1998, we embarked on what became called the light rail study. But we studied a connection, it was called Art Center to Town Center, and it studied a rail connection from Art Center, the Midtown Art Station, MARTA Station, out to Town Center with a spur that went off into Cherokee and two circulators. And it was, 18 years ago, it was a $3 billion initiative. But even in the current BRT discussions, a lot of the engineering and a lot of the work that was done on that study was taken and incorporated into what is now a proposed $500 to $600 million BRT system. I honestly would tell you that I would prefer light rail, but the question becomes, can we afford $2.5 to $3 billion for light rail if we can get a true transit system that connects us? Connectivity is what it's all about. So I want to congratulate Advance Atlanta. You know, there's a lot of, and I've been involved in a lot of leadership groups, a lot of groups that come together, talk a big game, and then they go on back and they don't actually do anything. For y'all to have convened this audience, I know there's only 75 people here, but as they said in Top Gun, it's a target-rich environment. We have elected officials here, we have leaders here. Y'all know who's here. There are a lot of people here who are paying attention. And I assume, Maria, that the press will dutifully report on what has been said here. But the fact is that for Cobb County, and Emory for that matter, for Gwinnett County, and for this region to be truly competitive in the markets in which we compete today, internationally, and that's where we compete, then we have got to add more transportation choices for our residents and for our visitors, for our employers and their employees. And those choices have to include a reliable, efficient transit solution. And it has to address, eventually, connectivity throughout the region. So again, Advance Atlanta, thank you for bringing awareness to this. You know, the millennials, you guys are the people that are driving. You're bigger than the baby boomers. I hate going to these meetings because I feel like the oldest guy in the room, and I may very well be. But y'all are driving this dialogue, and you need to continue to do that, and don't let up, because the traditional reasons for transit not coming to Cobb are now obsolete. All right? Those concerns, those issues have faded with the passage of time. And now y'all are driving the dialogue, and the millennials want to ride transit. So keep doing it. I'll be glad to show up anytime that I can say something positive, but until we have a transit solution for Cobb County, we are not going to be able to compete effectively in the international environment. So I've heard it several times, Danielle, there'll be questions. Let me turn it back over to you, but thank you for including me on the agenda.
So I know, I feel like, you know, we've been here a long time, people are maybe a little bit anxious. If you maybe want to approach any of the board members with questions, if you want to approach the speakers with questions,
can the speakers come back up so we can ask them a question?
There is a few other ones up here. I just want to thank everyone for coming. We really appreciate you making the effort on Thursday night. Please get home safely. Help yourself to more food,
beverages.